today. Turn with me in your Bibles to Matthew chapter number 5. Matthew chapter number 5 is where we'll spend our time this morning engaging in our preaching and teaching. If you need a Bible, shoot your hand up and someone will get a Bible to you. And we'll certainly have the verses and the scripture on the screen as well. So if you would just like to follow along on the screen, that's totally fine. And a blessing in the name of the Lord. Many of you know last week we were engaged in all kinds of great activities on behalf and in remembrance of Dr. Martin Luther King week. And many of you know after church, I had to catch a flight because we were doing some work in New York for the MLK Now with our homie and comrade Ryan Coogler and a bunch of folks here from the Bay Area. We were so blessed to join our folks and loved ones in New York. And soon thereafter, I told you all that I was going down to the Supreme Court to join a peaceful protest, praise God. I've been a part of the non-peaceful ones too, but this time was a peaceful protest. We were joining with some of our loved ones from across the country who were engaging in a protest they do every 5 years to recognize the anniversary of the Supreme Court's ruling to uphold the death penalty in the United States. So this is the 40th year anniversary of that ruling. And so we joined family members whose family members were victims, meaning they were murdered by some individuals who were actually executed, and we were joining the family members of those who were indeed executed by the death penalty. And it just happened to be that the next day, an individual was scheduled to be executed in the state of Virginia for a very tragic and gory and disturbing act of violence and murder that he perpetrated on a family in the state of Virginia. So his case was making it up to the Supreme Court, and folks were hoping for a stay of execution. It turned out that the stay of execution was not granted, so he was executed on, I think that was Wednesday. Over the last 40 years, over 1,400 people have been executed by the United States, and it is not certainly the case, I believe, that people who follow the ways of Jesus should be supporting or advocating the taking of lives. And it is a very, very difficult thing, I believe, for us to say that we want to stop killing and then we sanction killing in our names. And often the killing of folks by our state through executions are always racially disproportionate. And there is a growing discovery of people on death row who are actually innocent, and their charges are usually problematized. And there certainly are some folks who do engage in capital crimes. And so we believe, at least I hope we believe, I know I believe, I think the scriptures are consistent in helping us to be reminded that it is never too late for redemption. Amen. It's never too late for people's lives to be changed and turned around. And if you think about the scriptures, there are a whole number of people who actually were guilty of murder, and God figured out a way to use them to do things that have been a blessing to us even some millennia later. And so we joined that protest, and we knew that we were risking arrest, and I think many of us were prepared to be arrested and detained if we, you know, did not hurry up and finish with our service on the Supreme Court steps. But it turned out that our arrest and detention proved to be much longer than any of us had imagined, and the state in which we were held and treated proved to be more brutal than anything that I've participated in a act of civil disobedience. And so we were detained for over 30 hours by the Supreme Court police, who handed us over to the Washington, D.C. Metro Police. And they booked us in the Central Booking Jail, which is, I assume, because we were in the paddy wagon truck chained to the truck. So I couldn't tell through the little hole in the back of the truck if we were driven through town or driven underneath somewhere. But I think we're pretty close. But what was so difficult and I think tragic was our conditions. We were arrested, I think, around 10 a.m. And we didn't get any food until about, I'd say, I don't know, 5 o'clock. And they had us, detained and cuffed pretty tight. They, cut up our arms pretty good. And they put us in a cell that had insects and roaches crawling up and down the walls incessantly. And I'm talking about, like, you just had to take off your shoe every 10 seconds to kill a bug that was scurrying across the wall. And they had metal cots that were, there without mattresses. So we were sleeping on these hard metal mattresses with bugs. You know, all the dead bugs we were killing, would fall on our mattress, and we would have to figure out a way without touching them or squishing things where we have to sleep. And that went on pretty much from, I'd say, we got in there maybe around 2 or 3 o'clock. And that was our experience until maybe 6, 7 a.m. the next morning. And I think for many of us who were there, including the guards and even some of the other, folks who were arrested in the District of Columbia, as they were coming in, they were like, wow, this seems to be a whole lot for y'all standing on the Supreme Court steps with a sign that said no executions. And it did. I thought it was quite excessive, but I think it is indicative of the kind of season that we're about to enter into, where our president has certainly said that he is going to, I think he said he will end it. His administration will end the treatment that is favorable in his and their eyes towards what he calls protesters, looters, and rioters, and figure out a way to reenact the age of law and order. And so I guess for me and for all of us who experienced that, I'm definitely gonna have to go back, because the next day when they brought us before the judge, rather than citing and releasing us or dropping the charges, they charged us with some charges that we're gonna have to go back and stand before the judge on February 24th. And it's a possibility that we're gonna have to pay a fine or face further incarceration for our actions. And they made sure that they held us until the end. We were like one of the last folks. It was about 60 folks in the jail that day. I think all of them were African-American except for two of African-American males, at least we saw, except for two who were Latino. And then our group of 18, there were about 12 or 13 individuals who were some of our white brothers. So it was very telling to be in the jail and just see that daily it is probably a parade of black, overwhelmingly black and increasingly brown men and women who are going before the judge. They tied us in chains from my arms, our arms to our waist and our feet. And they just led us around like we were just about to tear up something. Amen. And I must admit, I thought about it. No, I'm just playing. It's like, well, if I'm up in here, I might as well get my worth, praise God. No. But it was so fascinating, because some of the young men, obviously, who had been in there a few times, they told us a couple of things. One of them said, it's obvious you guys don't belong here. You guys just need to just endure this, because what they want to do is break you down and get you to act out so they can keep you longer. And a couple of the fellas, we did see them, act out. Some, when they brought us into the holding space, it was about 60 fellas, no benches, no chairs, hard floor. They didn't give us any food for the whole day. We had one public trough where people could, go to the restroom in. And some of us who've been incarcerated, some of you that have been incarcerated, this may be normal. And I see some brothers shaking their head like, yeah, Pastor, that's how it gets down. And so I think at the very least, all of us who are working to change this system have to have some principles as relates to how human beings should be treated. No matter what you do, I think we should all still be treated as human beings. And there's a certain level I think of just human dignity. I don't think people should be sleeping in quarters with bugs and vermin, and people should get food, people should get water, people should be sleeping in places where it's warm or cold, it's an appropriate temperature. Someone said, well, Pastor, it's not Club Med, it's jail. I said, well, I understand it's jail, but, you know, there's a long way from, like, Club Med and, like, warm, like, just sleeping in a place where you're not every 10 seconds killing a bug that's crawling up your pants and in your clothes and et cetera, et cetera. So it was, for many of us, a pretty difficult and traumatic experience. I thank God that we got out. I didn't get any phone calls, so that's why I didn't get a chance to give anybody any updates. But I appreciate everybody that prayed for me and prayed for our group and my family and everybody who was worried about us. It was something that I think may be required for many, many more of us in these years to come. To put our bodies out there on the line and let the system know that the more many of us find out what's happening in some of these places, I think it'll help fuel our resistance to the evil that is trying to arise in this nation on top of the already existing evil that we've been trying to dismantle and resist. Amen. So I thank you for your prayers and your support. Keep us in prayer, especially if we have to go back and deal with more of these people in this system. I don't necessarily want to, go back to jail. Amen. I think I've had my fill for this season. But if we got to, then we must. So pray that God gives us some mercy and gives them a little bit of enlightenment so we can keep doing the work that God's called us to do. Is that all right? All right, all right, all right. Turn with me again, Matthew chapter number 5, verse 6. We are certainly embarking on this continued series during our consecration called Soul Food. And if you've been here the last couple weeks, you know that our whole series has been trying to help us appreciate that we are what we eat. And it's not just in the natural sense around the food you put in your body and in your system, but it's also a spiritual and a mental and a soul, if you will, diet that I believe we are being called to participate in that will help us be in a better position in this moment to be faithful to the will of God that God has called for God's people in this moment. Now, let's be clear, my brothers and sisters and loved ones, that it is the case that what we put in our system will have the most power over us. And in this regard, we are then called to make sure that we are feeding ourselves food that nourishes our soul, food that hopefully will produce and create the kind of soul work that is actually strengthening parts of us that, if we keep it real, we don't pay that much attention to until trouble comes knocking on our door. Hello, somebody. Amen. You know, it's easy to call on the Lord when all hell is breaking loose. Oh, Jesus is the first thing to come out your mouth. Oh, Jesus. And sometimes you ain't even trying to call on Jesus. You just... the first thing to come out your mouth. But how many know when things are going okay, Jesus can often be a distant memory, or at least a distant second in who and what you are depending on. But in these moments, I want to submit that our consecration and these seasons of spiritual disciplines are important because they help produce a routine of us engaging in soul work that does indeed help produce a soul force so we can resist the powers and the forces of evil and degradation and oppression and sin that is working to harm our body, our soul, and our spirit. So today, we're going to continue in this series, and make every effort to try to build and keep building as we go through the rest of our season of consecration. Matthew chapter number 5, verse number 6. One simple verse. It is a powerful verse. It's a part of the Beatitudes. Jesus was preaching and teaching to large crowds of people on the Mount of Olives. And it's known in the Christian tradition that in many respects, Jesus was offering a companion of the top 10, 11, 12 things that you should do if you're going to follow Jesus well, if you're going to participate in the kingdom of God, that these are things that must be indicative of your life. It was almost as if Jesus was giving everybody another 10 commandments, right? Like Moses brought down these commandments to the children of Israel coming out of Egypt, and Jesus is now doing something very similar to all of these folks who are gathering and trying to figure out, how can I respond to this message of Jesus who was saying to all of us, repent, turn your lives around, because a new kingdom, a new way of life is coming. I don't want to preach on all of these verses because it would take me all day, but in the interest of time, and certainly with our topic, Matthew chapter 5, verse number 6, it simply says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for you will be filled. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for you will be filled. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. Bow your heads with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the word of God that has been read for us, the people of God. We ask you to hide this word in our hearts so we will not sin against you. And please send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest upon me and even the hearers of your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen. All right. Blessed are you who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for you will be filled. Somebody holler, fill me up, Lord. Fill me up, Lord. Now, it is indeed, I think, no mystery that one of the greatest developments of the last week was not the Warriors beating the Cleveland Cavaliers. And who else they beat this week? I think they beat the Houston Rockets. And they beat another top 10 team. That was not the biggest development of the week, praise God. I think on Thursday, many of us watched with some mixed feelings, if not horror, amen, the inauguration of Donald Trump. And it certainly has, I think, produced, rightly so, in many people all across the country and all across the world, feelings of anxiety, anger, feelings of nervousness, feelings of violation. And that was obvious yesterday. Three of our friends helped to lead and spark a march that happened in over 600 cities. And the Women's March was an amazing expression of the power of women and all of us who believe that it is not just enough to pray or hope or click your heels and wish upon a star. Amen. That if anything is going to change, how many of you know that that change is going to happen because we make it happen? Amen. And it is indeed the case that the three sisters, Tamika Mallory and Linda Sarsour and Carmen Perez, they're part of the Justice League. Real dope sisters that we work with joined a larger coalition of folks. And it was a massive expression, not just here in the United States, but there were marches in Antarctica, I saw. Amen. People out there marching. I think it was Antarctica. Maybe that was Alaska. It was snowy. It was somewhere where there was some snow. Don't just play. There was marches in other countries and continents. And you know, I think it's telling because Dr. King did say that we are all caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, right? That there is a certain connectedness all across time, all across place, all across location. And it's fascinating to see how an event in one part of the world can definitely have a ripple effect in another part of the world. And we, I think, who are followers of Jesus and people that are really trying to be faithful stewards of this earth and of our country, which has an over determination of the larger world, right? Let's be clear that the United States of America is very much over influencing the whole world. Amen. We produce more trash, our country does, than any other country in the world, which is accelerating a lot of the environmental challenges. We certainly sell more weapons than any other country in the world. Dr. King said that the United States is the greatest purveyor of violence in the world. And that was before Donald Trump became the president. Amen. So it ain't like, you know, Donald Trump is the beginning of our problems. Amen. He's a problem, though. At least I would say so. But our beloved President Barack Obama was a part of the problem. And before him, so was Bush. And so was Clinton. And so was Bush. And so was Reagan. And so was Carter. And so was Nixon. And so was all them jokers, amen, were a part of the problem. And guess what? If we are not a part of the solution, then you and I as the church will be part of the problem. And so this is why following the ways of Jesus is such a high stake proposition. Because if you are following Jesus well, you will never be let off the hook about what must be changed in you. I mean, often we will pray and ask God to change the world. God will say, well, first I'll start by changing you. Because if I change you, how many of you know you and me in our transformed person will then figure out a way to change the world? And this is part and parcel of why I believe this verse and this passage is so critical, because often when we read the scriptures, we don't fully appreciate that we are reading a translation from other languages of a text that is not always clear without extra study the fullness of what we are being called to do. This scripture is often very much on the surface read solely as a spiritual exercise. Blessed are you who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for you shall be filled. And we think, particularly us who are serious about soul work, who are serious about our lives being transformed, that righteousness only speaks to a very narrow sense of moral decisions. Decisions about what you do when nobody else is watching. Decisions about your behavior with those kind of people that you run around in the streets with. Decisions about how you act when folk get on your nerves. Decisions about who you may fall in love with. Decisions about what your response is when somebody knock you upside your head. We reduce righteousness to a very narrow moral code. But when you take into consideration that righteousness in the original language is not just about your personal morality, but in the biblical text, righteousness, dikaiosune, also that the original word means justice. So whenever you see the word righteousness that has been translated by many of our English translators in the text that we read, whenever we see the word righteousness, you would be doing well to add "and justice" to the end of that statement. Because in many respects, righteousness is not a radical personal set of decisions. It is also speaking to the kind of systemic and structural attention that you and I must pay attention to if we are going to be faithful stewards of God's earth and certainly followers of Jesus in the world. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness and justice. Now, in the biblical text, this word is found 300 times. So it isn't as if you get to ignore it, like many folks do, amen. I find it so fascinating how many folks, particularly from our kind of Western Christian evangelical spaces, want to reduce righteousness to a couple of things and leave out all the other things. But this is why following Jesus is not a multiple choice exam. Wish I had a church this morning. Amen. You don't get to say, I'm going to follow Jesus with A or B or C and ignore the D that says all of the above. How many of you know that you must make decisions in your life that do reflect the transformation of God that has happened, and you must also make decisions in your life that reflect the care of your neighbor. That we are dismantling systems and structures that do harm to both the body and the soul. And so if we're serious about this soul food in this season, I want to suggest to you and I that righteousness and justice as the diet, the steady diet that you and I must engage in is critical if we are going to be faithful to God and instruments of God's purpose in this season. I believe, particularly when you do the theological work around righteousness, many of us who are products of the Pentecostal charismatic tradition, we appreciate that we come out of a Wesleyan or a Methodist tradition, and our notions of holiness, particularly doctrinally, are often kind of arising out of John Wesley and Charles Wesley, these revivalists from, I think, the 1700s or so. And it was fascinating because I try to tell some of my evangelical friends and those who are, you know, very narrowly describing righteousness as personal holiness, the Wesleyans said that there is no personal holiness without social holiness. Right? Which means that you can't be around here hung up on people's personal decision making and then be ignoring the social, political, cultural decisions that often create hell for a lot of people that you may never meet. I mean, it's interesting, while we were in jail, we were trying to make the best of our time. So we had some great conversations with some of the young men. And it was so fascinating talking to a few of the young men. One of them said, Pastor Mike, I'm in here because I was in my house and, I was smoking a little bit. And, I got a little, upset because I locked myself in the bathroom and I couldn't get out. So I broke the bathroom door to get out my own bathroom in my own house. And he said, my neighbor called the police on me. Because they heard some banging, and when the police came in and saw the broken door in my house, they arrested me for destruction of property in my own apartment. So he's sitting in jail. He has a job, and now I spent about 12 hours with this fella. I hadn't talked to him too much because, he had that little mean mug on his face. I had my own mean mug on my face, and I was like, I'm not fooling with nobody up in here because I'm just not here for it today. Amen. But how many know the longer you spend time with folk, amen, you start to realize you both in the same boat, so might as well drop your pretenses, amen. Get to learn each other's names, hear each other's story. And we found out that both of us were in there for something that probably did not warrant us to be in that position. Another brother was trying to make the metro train, and he didn't have any money, so he jumped the turnstile. And they arrested him for jumping the turnstile. Now, there were other folks in there. Some guy was homeless, and he, I think, was sleeping in somebody's porchway, and they arrested him for that. Another person took somebody's food. I guess they were coming out of a restaurant, and he grabbed someone's food and ran, and the police stopped him. So I'm listening to at least 6 of the 60 folks' charges for being in jail. And, I was thinking to myself, man, can you imagine if we had food for everybody to eat? He wouldn't be here. Can you imagine if, police used discretion and didn't, arrest somebody for tearing up their own door? I mean, he probably shouldn't have tore up his door, but is that an arrestable offense? Can you imagine? One of the young fellows in there saying, we live in the greatest country on the earth. And I said, well, why is this the greatest country on the earth? He went to, he was in there, I think, for doing something silly as well. And I used the other brother's name. I said, well, did you know in other countries you don't even have to pay to ride public transportation? He was like, what? I said, you don't have to pay to go to college? What? You don't have to pay to get health care? What? I said, so is this still the greatest country? He said, I need to go visit some other countries. Touch your neighbor, right? That how we structure our society can often, feed people's behavior that may be considered criminal, but sometimes are acts of survival. Regardless of how we may think about it, I want to submit to you that when we talk about social holiness in this moment in time, you and I need to have a stimulated, redirected, dare I say, a transformed imagination about what does society look like and what is the role for you and I to help facilitate such society where social holiness is a part of our conversation as followers of Jesus in the world. It's not just enough for you and I to obsess about personal behavior and we ignore the social context in which we live. Give your neighbor a high five and tell him I'm about that social holiness, amen. At least I'm about to try to be about it, amen. And so when you and I take seriously that righteousness and justice are the same thing, that righteousness is justice and justice is righteousness, then hopefully we read the scripture in a different way where it says, blessed are you who hunger and thirst for righteousness and justice, for you will be filled. What will you be filled with, then, is the question. Because a lot of us can be filled with a whole lot of stuff that ain't worth a lot. Amen. Use your imagination about all the things that you and I can be filled with that we are quick to get rid of. And I want to submit to you that part of what the scripture lifts up to us today, if we take it seriously, is that if you and I hunger and thirst for righteousness, one of the first things the scripture says is that we will be blessed. Everybody say blessings. If you and I are filled up with the blessings of God as a result of us hungering and thirsting for the things of God, how many of you know the blessings that come will then be a blessing not just to me personally, but they will bless then the entire community around me? Jesus said that it was his food to do the will of the one who sent him. And part of what I think our challenge, particularly in this Western capitalistic patriarchal society, if you will, is that we define blessings with the radical me versus the radical we. That there is a self-individualized framework where we are all trying to be overly obsessed with ourselves. Now, it is not my suggestion that you should not care about yourself. Because there is a moment and a time where you need to take a step back and get yourself together. Jesus, when he was here, he was doing all this ministry, but you found the pattern of Jesus to be that when he was preaching to the crowds and he was healing everybody, there would come a time where Jesus would retreat to the mountain by himself to pray. Because Jesus knew work with our people will drive you crazy. Amen. So Jesus said, I got to get away from you wonderful folk, praise God, and I'm going to go over here and I'm going to reconnect with God so I can come back and be my best self with you. You see that rhythm there? Do your work, do your ministry, do your calling, but take some time to retreat for some self-care with your creator, with some folk who love you, so you can show up your best self to do your calling. That is a different idea of blessings than the kind of idea where I'm just going to worry about me, and I hope you get yours. And don't you come talking to me about yours, because I'm trying to get mine. How many of you know that that is kind of the way many of us are naturally raised to deal in this capitalistic society? That it's the radical individual. But how many of you can appreciate that none of us got here by ourselves? I wish I could talk to somebody in here today. Amen. I think that the scripture says that if it had not been for God who was on your side, that you would have lost a long time ago. So everything that we have it because God has made a way for you and I to experience some blessings. And how many of you know that if God has blessed you, you got to be a blessing to somebody else? Lord, talk somebody in here. When God blessed Abraham, Abraham was told, through you, I will bless all the nations of the world. It wasn't God told Abraham, get your money. That was not God and Abraham's discussion. Get your money, bruh. That's it. And good luck with that. Give me a tithe, but just get your money. Ain't it interesting how we talk about our way of living today, even though many of us say we follow Jesus, is so different than how Scripture describes how we're supposed to be living? But yeah, we sure enough can get all kind of self-righteous when things that don't affect us, you know, get all upset and we like, oh, the devil is a lie. Well, how about this? If you and I live our lives in such a way where blessings are only interpreted as things that benefit only you and your four favorite people, then you are not following the ways of Jesus. And we should be honest about that so we can then repent and ask God to make us better and more faithful. But don't we dare try to make God's call to take care of one another something that is only a time-bound place. I had someone tell me, well, that's because, you know, McBride, they were living in another culture in another time, and there was another economic system in place, and, you know, they had, you know, to do this and they had to do that. So I don't have to do that because we live in the United States of America where, you know, it's just a different time and a different place. And I'm like, all right, well, you know, that's wrong, but I appreciate your thinking here. Blessings are not intended for the radical me. Blessings are about all of us. I can't experience the blessings of God and you be experiencing suffering and pain. And I'm supposed to be happy. We're supposed to be the part of the same body. What blessings then must you and I ask God for, not just for myself, but for all of us? In this season, some of us are filled with anxiety. So one of the blessings we need to ask God for is peace. Some of us are filled with hopelessness. So we need to ask God, Lord, give me some hope. Some of us are sick in our body and sick in our soul and sick in our mind. So we need to ask God for some healing. The trauma has been real. And it's a blessing for you and I to be healed. And how many know healing comes in all kinds of forms? Some of us need to go get some therapy. Some of us need to go get some medicine. Some of us need to come to prayer and watch God do something miraculous. But don't put God in a box and say, God can only heal me one kind of way. If you're sick, seek healing all the ways that are available to you. Hallelujah. Because some of us put God in a box, and how many know God is bigger than your box? Sometimes God will heal you like that. Sometimes God will lay you on a couch and make you talk to somebody. Sometimes God will put you in a hospital and let somebody look in your insides. But anyway, you bless me, Lord, I will be satisfied. Give your neighbor a high five and tell him, oh, I need a blessing. I need a blessing. I need a blessing. So one quick question, what kind of blessings need to fill your life today? Healing, restoration, faith, confidence, joy, peace. How will whatever blessing you're getting bless more than you? It's a good question for you to think about this week. Amen. Break out of the tendency, even with this new season of political leadership, to get over obsessed with how you are going to survive. Amen. Amen. You need to figure out how we gonna survive, because it is in the we that we will survive. You aren't strong enough to survive by yourself. I know some of you think you smart, praise God, and you think you got a lot of money and connections, but how many of you know there will be a problem that your strength won't be able to help you get out of? And when that time comes, it's good to have somebody to call. Say, help me out, somebody. Give your neighbor one more high five and tell them, I need a blessing. I need a blessing. The next thing the scripture says, blessed are they that hunger and thirst, hunger and thirst, hunger and thirst. Understand, my loved ones, I think that when you and I are hungry and thirsty for God, we will be filled with a new imagination. Somebody holler, new imagination. Now, I don't know if you ever ate something late at night and you had a terrible dream. Amen. I don't know. You know, sometimes you have these dreams or these ideas and you think it was that burrito you ate last night, right? It's like, I don't know if this is of God or of the burrito, amen. If this was Taco Bell or if this was the bread of life. Listen, part of what you and I have to appreciate is that when you eat, listen, what you put in your body will often be spread through your bloodstream to all kind of parts of your brain and your heart, and everything that you don't need, your body releases. It sucks out all that is valuable, and it releases that which it does not need. Think about if you and I have an appetite that is hungry and thirsty for God, and God says that God will fill it. I think one of the great things that God will fill us up with is a different imagination. Some of us are too limited in our thinking. So we think only what we know or have read in a book, what someone we trust has told us. But I believe that God has a source of knowledge and wisdom that transcends some of our PhDs and master degrees and MBAs. Got quiet in here. I know we're an educated crowd. But how many can be real and say, there's some problems I'm facing right now that my education can't help me get out of? Mm-hmm. You know your what's going on with your son and your daughter ain't no book for that. Amen. What's happening in your mind and in your soul? What's even happening in our country? There is no book for what we gonna do. That in some respects, we are being called as the church, as followers of Jesus, to have an expanded imagination about what we are called to create, who we are called to be, what we are called to do. And if you and I are pursuing God with such reckless abandon that, God, I want my appetite, particularly as I am fasting, I want this consecration to change my desires so I crave for you. I crave for you in all your fullness, not just in the worship, not just in the gathering to preach and pray, but I crave in you in the way I treat my loved ones, in the way I treat those in my community, in the way I treat my children. I want to be so hungry that my appetite is often demonstrating that I am receiving the nutrients of being in relationship with the living God, that when I need to forgive you, it's not hard. When I need to love you, it's not hard. I mean, I got to tell you, while I was there in jail, I'm glad I was on a consecration. I'm glad I was fasting because my body wasn't craving for a whole lot of foolishness. I don't know if I could have made it if I was craving for a Twinkie, praise God, and craving for a porterhouse steak, and my body's just trying to figure out what in the world is going on. But for 15 days leading up to that moment, I had already put my body under subjection in such a way that you and I and we and me, and the lights are going to come back on in a second, thank God, that you and I and me and we were dealing with a certain kind of craving after God, and my whole appetite had shifted. When they served that bologna sandwich, because I was on a fast, guess what I told them? I'm not going to eat that bologna sandwich. And it helped, too, that I don't like bologna, praise God. When they was trying to give out Kool-Aid, I said, give me some water. When they was getting on my nerves, and I had to tap into the fruit of the Spirit that I talked about on Sunday. Joy, peace, love, patience, kindness. I thank God I was on a fast before I went into that unexpected jail, because it gave me a new imagination even while I was incarcerated. And I want to tell you, my loved ones, we will not be able to anticipate where we will end up. But if we are preparing ourselves ahead of time with what we are consuming, if we are helping our appetites to be curbed so we can pursue after the things that God loves. Not the things that I love, but the things that God loves. If God loves unity among God's people, then I have to pursue unity. If God loves healing, I have to pursue healing. If God loves justice, I have to pursue justice. These become then my food and my drink. So question, what then does this new appetite enable you to do with your imagination? Can you see a different reality before it manifests itself? Can you and I see those things that are not as though they already are? God's going to need some folk to be able to walk into some situations and not be overdetermined by the despair that is in the room, by the tension that is in your house, by the violence that is in your neighborhood. God's going to need somebody to be able to walk in and see peace where there is no peace, see hope where there is no hope, see victory where there is no victory. And if you and I, as the people filled with the things of God's love, joy, and peace, can't bring that to the table, then we need to pray and ask God, fill me up, Lord, till I overflow. Last thing the scripture says is you will be filled. I believe God wants you and I to know that sustainability will be the result of we who hunger and thirst for God, for righteousness, for justice, for fairness, for holy living and holy systems. God will sustain you and I in this season. God will strengthen you and I in this season. God will give you and I what we need. Why? Because everything that I'm putting inside of me, God is extracting all of the value. The difficulty that has been used to try to destroy me, God says, I can redeem that. The pain that you feel in your relationships, in your job, in your community, in your own being, God says, I can redeem that. I can cause that to produce an anointing inside of you that you may not be able to explain, but everybody else will be able to see. You'll be surrounded by odds that were against you, and God will figure out a way to help you transcend the thing that the enemy meant for our evil. God says, I can turn that thing into a redemptive opportunity to sustain and strengthen. And guess what happens when you're sustained? God says, I get to get some glory. I get to use your testimony as an opportunity to demonstrate to an unbelieving world, unbelieving loved one, unbelieving community that I am real. Some of us today need to invite God to fill us up. What good is it to engage in the disciplines of the Spirit and not be filled with the Spirit, filled with God's power, filled with the things that give you and I the ability to do the supernatural call, the thing that no one else is signing up to do? You seem to be compelled to that thing. Do I got anybody in here like that? It's like, man, I'm trying to tap out, and for some reason, I keep getting pulled in. Told my family, I'm through with y'all. I'm done. I've had it. Y'all crazy. I can't take it no more. God keeps reconnecting you to some of these folk. Some of you are trying to escape certain callings that you know are from God. They're not from me or another person. They're from God. God said, I need to fill you up because this season, God has need of you. Me, we. So my prayer for us is for God to fill us up. May we hunger and thirst for God, for the things of God, for God's strategies and God's heart and God's will. Then may we invite God to fill us up with what we need so we can do God's work right now. God's awaiting us. Come on, stand with me, everyone.